Praise be to God, man. God has been good to me. Glory to God, glory to God. Hey, we're gonna just keep right on. I'm so glad I went ahead and took the time. To teach on that right now. So, we've been searching on, let me get, because my emotions all like supercharged. Jesus. Okay. Woo. Glory to God. See, some of y'all ain't getting excited, man, by Jesus. You know, I'm not saying you got to run around and you run around and say, Jesus, that ain't part of my personality. Well, maybe you need to change your personality. Jesus will help you do that too, man. I never really was the one. I mean, I've always been loud. You know, we just Robinson, we just loud. But now I'm loud in Christ. I ain't talking loud and saying nothing. I'm talking loud and saying something. And if you listen to me, I believe that you'll receive Jesus. Glory to God. But we've been searching this. We've been walking this walk and searching this search. And if you have not come to the conclusion, I know I've come to the conclusion. I've come to the conclusion. Jesus is the answer for everything that I need. He is the answer. If I need my bills paid, Jesus. If I have struggles in my relationship with my wife, my children, my job, Jesus is the answer. Sometimes you'll get to the point to where you will begin to think, well, maybe if I do it this way. It's time to go back to some basics. I taught on the basics of Christianity about 2 years ago, 2.5 years ago. And go to the book of Hebrews. It's my wife's favorite book. It's talking about Jesus blowing some coffee. Hebrews. Some of y'all get that joke right now. Hebrews chapter 5. Chapter 6, verse 1. Everybody there? Do you got your Bible out there? You need your Bible. I want y'all to grab hold of this now. Look at verse 1. It says, therefore, leaving the principles of the doctrine of Christ, let us go on to perfections, not laying again the foundation of repentance from dead works and of faith toward God, of the doctrine of the baptisms, and of laying on hands, and of the resurrection of the dead, and of eternal judgment. And this will we do if God permit. Now, we taught on that, and it will be in your best interest to go look at that series. But I'm going to come right in on the bottom half of verse 1. It says, repentance from dead works. Repentance from dead works. I have learned now what some of these dead works more of what these dead works are. And a dead work is anything that you do, and you're trying to come up with the answer. You're trying to figure it out on your own. That's a dead work. What it say? It says, unless the Lord buildeth a house, you labor in vain. Now, some of us will start down the path of dead works, not realizing that you're going down that path. But I'm beginning to understand more and more about things that I do. Any work that I do is going to be birthed out of who I am. Who are you? That's one person. Only folk here. One person spoke. Oh, Lord Jesus. Everybody say that. Everybody say it loud enough. I am the righteousness of God. I am, come on. Everybody, come on, everybody.
I am the righteousness of God.
Y'all, come on, where y'all voices at? Y'all talk so loud on other days. Anyway, I am the righteousness of God. Oh, Lord Jesus. Okay. That's who you are. That's who you are. And the Bible also says that without works, faith is dead. Now, you don't want to get caught up in doing specific things and saying that I'm showing you my faith. Well, if it's not producing anything, then it's a dead work. Like, I don't care what the world will tell you. The world will say, hard work, good education, hard work, sweat equity, put forth your best effort. And then the world will say, have a good attitude, then you'll make your way prosperous. Well, guess what? That's not the case. Because my daddy, he was one of the hardest working men I had ever seen. He was a hard working man. And he only had, ninth grade education? My dad knew how to count. You couldn't beat my dad out of money. He knew how to do math. He was real, real good. But he had an eighth grade education. You know, because back in 1936 when he was born, there wasn't a whole lot to do. You know, he picked cotton and stuff like that, and you know, all that other dumb stuff, and you know, in the South, and you know, it just wasn't a whole lot to do for a lot of young black men. It really wasn't, but go to school, but then they had to stop and they had to go to work because ends were not meeting. And if you ain't figured out right now, ends will never meet. Ends don't meet. You can't meet an end. No, God will have to meet those needs. But he was one of the hardest working men. I mean, even up to the time my father got cancer. And they said, Ira, go home. He showed back up for work. No, I got to put in my 10 today. You going to tell me not to go home. I'm going to work. And he said, I remember one time he got so mad at me. I was tired. I was playing football. I was going to school. I was making pretty decent grades. You know, I had a little part-time job working like 25 hours a week. And then you go to school 25 hours a week. You already work 50. Boy, what is school? What is school? What, 6 hours a day? 6 hours a day. So you multiply that time 5 days a week. Then you top on another 25 hours at a job. Then you tap on football. It's like, you tired. And that's a lot to take on. But then folk called me in to work, and they wanted me to work an extra 4 or 5 hours. And my daddy got mad at me. Mad. Why you ain't going to work? Shoot. Boy, that's free money. You ain't doing nothing but sitting in that room. Daddy, I'm tired. I've been at school all day. I worked all night last night. Then I got up early this morning. I went to school. The one night I got off, and I got to go back to school in the morning. I'm a little tired. He got so mad at me. My daddy, he worked hard and worked hard and worked hard. And guess what he got? Nothing. So when the world says that's what you do, you like, it's something wrong with that picture. It's a dead work. It's a dead work. There is a level, there is a point where you do have to work hard. Don't get me wrong. Don't get up here and say, Pastor, it's a dead work for me to be showing up to this job. You need to get your behind. See, I almost said something. Don't tell me wonder what I was going to say. Get your behind up, go in the bathroom, do what you got to do, and then go to work. Show up on time, and while you're there, put forth your best effort. See, if you take Jesus with you, when you get there, you ain't always got to pray, Lord Jesus, now these folks going to drive me crazy today. No, you show up for work and you work your butt off. And you don't make excuses. If you made a mistake, own up to it and move on. Let's go. But there's a level of hard work. There's a level of sweat equity. But now, it's time for us to start really receiving these things that we've been believing for. That is where we are at now. That is where we're at now. Amen. That's where we're at now. Because that is the proof of who we are. If you say that you are the righteousness of God, and you say that what you believe and what you're doing has been birthed out of who you are. When if it's birthed, if an action that you're doing, if it's birthed out of who you are, it's birthed from God, you'll begin to see fruit on the trees. Because it's coming from the root. Mm-hmm. If I go plant an apple tree in the middle of the yard, they say it takes about three to 5 years before you actually see. Actuality, if you look at it, about 2 years, you'll see little bitty old small apples on the tree. They'd be about this big. Hmm. About that big. You could eat them, because if you try to eat one of them, it'd taste so bitter. And we had back in Tennessee, we had two Bradford pear trees. And them trees, the first year they was there, they just started blossoming. And then after 2 years we were there, they got really, really big. One of them just sprouted out real big. You could see that the tree bark, it kind of like began to separate. From it, not from itself, but it began to split, and then it began to fill in. It's so cool to just watch it develop. And then before you know it, it got so big, they gave us some real shade in front of our house. We had two of them in front of our porch. But then you begin, after about three years, you begin to see these little bitty old things. So now we sold the house a whole bunch of years ago now, and now we're here. But I'm sure now, whoever bought that house, they're experiencing some nice sized pears, right? Really, really nice sized pears. And it's really, really cool to see different things develop over that time. Well, that's the way it is with the Word of God. If you've been pushing in with God, with the dead work, you'll work your butt off for 40 years and won't see no real fruit. You won't see any fruit. So now it's time for this righteousness that who we say we are. Now it's time to see the fruits of this righteousness. It's time to see the fruits of this righteousness. It's time to see the fruits of it. Oh, glory to God, man. Oh, yeah, 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 Lord. Okay, I'll say that. If people don't see the fruit of the righteousness in you, if they don't see the fruit of it, I'm going to go back. Don't start trying to come up with something yourself, because then that means you're going to be returning back to dead works. The book of Galatians says it like this. Hold your finger here. Go to Galatians. Go to Galatians chapter, because it's like three books over. Galatians chapter 3. Look what it says, verse 1. Well, y'all there in Hebrews, right? And you go to 2 Thessalonians, 1 Thessalonians, then you hit Ephesians, and you hit Galatians. It's a little bit, few books to the left. Look at first verse 1. He says this, verse 1. Oh, foolish, y'all there? Everybody there? I still hear pages turning. I still see some of y'all flipping. Y'all through flipping? Y'all there? We there? Are we there? Okay, here we go. Look what he said in verse 1. Oh, foolish Galatians, who have bewitched you that you should not obey what? The truth. The truth. It didn't say obey a fact. It didn't say obey a law. It didn't say obey some kind of rule. It says obey what?
The truth.
The truth. Before whose eyes Jesus Christ has been evidently set forth crucified among you. This only would I learn of you, receive ye the Spirit by what? The works of the law. Hold on. I thought Jesus died and he made us free from the law. Look what it says. It says, This only what I learned of you, receive ye the Spirit by the works of the law or by hearing of faith. See, when you, if people don't begin to see who you are, if examples of your own life, the Bible, Paul says it, he says, you are our epistles written on of our hearts. You are. People should begin to see a living epistle. If you go think about the New Testament, it doesn't end. In the end of the book of Malachi, Malachi was the club of actuality. If the end of the book of Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John, if you go and read at the end of those books was the end of the Old Testament, but they put it in the New Testament to show you that a new has come. But at the end of those books, when you see the death, burial and resurrection of Jesus Christ. At the end of those books, it's the transition from the Old Testament to the New Testament. So all the way through Matthew, all the way from Genesis to Malachi, Old Testament, Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John, end of the Old Testament and then springing into the new. Jesus opened up the door to the new covenant. The book of Acts, it is the Acts of the Holy Spirit. Where the book of Acts, it never ends. Why? Because now you, if you born again, and you have if you have accepted Jesus Christ your Lord, you have the Holy Spirit in you. Now, the acts or the works of the Holy Spirit should be manifested outside of your life every day. People should see Jesus. People should see God. They should see God. Now, he said, what did he say? He said, did you receive, he basically said, I'm going to read it out of the Good News Version. So we can really, really hear it. The world is this thing. Shut up. Are you kidding me? On these things, you got these power down to save your battery and stuff. And you gotta wait for it to charge back up. I'm sorry, it'll come on, it'll be on in a second. So let me go ahead and continue to say it like this. It says, oh, there you go. That was quick. Good. Praise God. Look what it said. Galatians chapter 3. Come on. Galatians chapter 3. He says, verse 1. O foolish Galatians, who hath bewitched you that ye should not obey the truth, before whose eyes Jesus Christ has been evidently set forth crucified among you? Oh, no, that ain't it. The world. That's King James Version. Good news version. I want the good news version. Where's that? Where is you? Oh, goodness gracious. Love these apps. Love them. Come back to it, because it's doing what it wants to do. I don't know why I shut off. But the good news version, it basically says that who has bewitched you that you can begin doing something out of your own actions and you didn't start doing it out of faith. So we're going to say verse 2 again. This only what I learned of you, received by the spirit of works of the law or by the hearing of faith. Are ye so foolish, having begun in the spirit? Are ye now made perfect by what? The flesh. He says, ain't no way in the world that you gonna be able to be made perfect now by going back and doing things in your own strength and in your own power. And they see me. If it's been some years now, years and years ago, old Ivory will cuss you out. That old Ivory is dead now. Therefore, if any man be in Christ, he is a new creature. Old things are passed away. Yeah. Now, when I first got born again, God saw me as perfectly holy, perfectly righteous. My surroundings and my thinking and other people's perception of me, all they saw was, Ivory, don't mess with him, he'll cuss you out. But God, because I accepted Jesus Christ as my Lord, when he looks down, when he sees me, he sees a blood-washed, blood-bought child of the Most High God. He sees me as his son. And he was looking at me through the eyes of Jesus Christ. He wasn't looking at me based on what I had done. He was looking at what his son had did for me. But people, notice we still doing this thing. Y'all think we moved on to something different. No, when you walk with God, you also gonna walk with people. People, all they still saw what was cuss out, doper, smoker, a liar, a smack in your mouth twice if you push them again. Okay, that's what people saw. But just like a woman who's getting pregnant, who has gotten pregnant, and it's so, I like the way Joyce Meyer's analogy does it. She says, "What if God, when a woman gets pregnant, all of a sudden the woman's belly becomes glass, where you can see straight through it?" And you can see the organs and you can see that the baby's being developed. Well, what if it's so cool? It doesn't. What does God do? Belly still, you still see a woman's belly and it's covered up. And you're like, she pregnant? Oh yeah, she pregnant. You got the little baby bump going on and it's all kind of cute and stuff. And some women, they just get real, real big. And some people, they just stay real, real skinny and petite. But they got their little marshmallow, like sitting there like, you need to eat a cheeseburger. You look skinny. You need to eat meat. I know this one lady, one of our neighbors, she was pregnant, and you know, she still be out there cutting grass. Oh, pushing that lawnmower. I'd be like, what are you doing? You know, you 8 months pregnant, you pushing a lawnmower. Go sit down for a while. But God, what was he doing? He keeps it hidden. That's the way it is. When the Spirit of God comes on the inside of you, you're born again. You begin, look what it says. Look what it says. He said, oh Lord Jesus. He said, are you so foolish, having begun in the Spirit? Are ye now made perfect by the flesh? You started this walk in God, in spirit. That's the starting point. You started this walk with God by confessing Jesus Christ your Lord. Now you're in the spirit. Spirit. You're in the spirit. Therefore, if any man be in Christ, he is a what? A new. A new what? A new creature. A new creation. What is this new creature? Christ inside of a man. And a man inside of Christ. That's the new creature. That's the new creature. Everybody say, I am a man. Not now, if you're a woman, play woman if you think you want to get hermeneutical about it. You know, I ain't talking about gender, we're talking about species. You mankind. Everybody, so if you want to say woman, go right on ahead and say woman. If you want to be gender correct, okay, but I can go with you on it. Okay, so you woman, say, everybody say, I'm a man in Christ, and Christ is in me. That's the new creature. That's a creature that has never existed before. So let's say your name. Let's put your name there now. I'm gonna say it first so you can get the gist of it. Say, I'm a new creature, Ivory, who's Ivory in Christ, and Christ in Ivory. So you put your name there, whatever your name is, Ivory in Christ, and Christ in Ivory. That's the new creature. That's the new creature. Did y'all say it and put your name down? You got to see, I'm teaching this man. Because God, he's trying to get your knees met. knows that you have bills. He knows that Jesus paid the price so that your children can be saved. Think about some of y'all out there. Some of your children are not even born again. Think about it. If they die, they go into hell. And here you are with Christ in you, and you won't tell them about Jesus. You can see marriages are falling apart. And here you are, you got a great marriage. I ain't talking about you men and women. I'm talking about real marriage. You ain't got a ring, and you ain't got the piece of paper to prove that you married. Marriage ain't nothing but a piece of paper. No, it ain't marriage. I am living proof of that. Marriage is not just a piece of paper. It's not. It is a man and a woman. And we're going to get back to that to y'all. I told y'all we're going to get back to that because I had to go back to teach this so that you can begin to see this growth. Here you are. You began this walk with God in spirit. You got to be really foolish to say, okay, I've done this. Now I'm going to come over here and I'm going to start doing it the world system's way. The world system says, medication, I'm depressed. The world system says, smoke a cigarette, I'm frustrated. The world says, drink some alcohol to calm your nerves. The world says, go see this psychiatrist so that you can handle your mental problems. I was talking to some kids the other day at work. And I was telling them, if every time he healed somebody, the word don't, because they talk about schizophrenia and stuff like that. And I was like, no, ain't no schizophrenia here. If you go read where Jesus cast the dumb spirit out of them, it don't mean dumb as a dumb, like you big dummy like Fred Sanford. But it doesn't mean that. It means a dumb. It means a spirit that's controlling the thoughts and ideas of that person. With Jesus, when he cast out the dumb spirit, if you look that word up in the Hebrew or the Greek, guess what it means? Schizophrenia. Oh, I don't need no medication to control this. I just need to believe that this demon get cast out. What did Jesus tell us to do? Cast out demons. Get out of them in Jesus' name. Well, see, if people don't begin to see the fruits of that, they'll chunk your belief right off end with all these other religions. If they don't see the fruit, they don't see the fruit. If they have to see the fruit. How are you to begin this walk in the spirit and then not continue it in, and then not stay in the spirit? Why would you want to go and start doing things in the flesh? Why don't you go back over to Genesis? Go all the way back over to Genesis. Now, I took 30 minutes to teach that point, and it's gonna make perfect sense to you now. Genesis, we're only there in Genesis. I told y'all to put you the mark there when we left off, when Adam and Eve was with each other. Chapter 2. Yeah. Verse 23. That's why I told y'all to put your legs by. And then when we left off last time?
Yeah.
Okay, look what it says. And Adam said, this is now bone of my bones and flesh of my flesh. She shall be what? Called woman because she was taken out of man. Therefore a man shall leave his mother and father and shall cleave unto his wife, and they shall be what? One flesh. Now, he is referring to flesh as a flesh. If you see Denise, you're going to see Denise. You're going to see a tall or Caucasian woman. If you see me, you're going to see a tall black man. But God doesn't see it that way. God sees Ivory and Denise as one. So now, this is a whole nother creature. Oh my goodness, come on people. Come on, I know y'all got that. I know y'all saw it. You got Christ in Christ. You got Christ in Denise, and Denise in Christ. Now you got Alvin Denise Christ. That's right. This one. This one. See, when you start talking about the body of Christ, if whatever your name is, the Bible calls us a peculiar people. Like, not as in like strange, like spooky strange, but peculiar. Here Jesus is, the head of the church. When you get born again, you come on the inside of Christ. Oh, guess who else is also in there? Your cousin, your uncle, your mother, your brother, your sister, your boss, whoever else that you work with. They may be in there too if they've accepted Jesus Christ as their Lord. But Jesus is the head. If you were to look at it, look at the body of Christ individually, it looked like a monster. You got all these different things. I saw, whoever saw the movie, but Keanu Reeves and Al Pacino, when that Keanu Reeves, he was a lawyer, and Al Pacino was the devil in disguise, and you know, it was a movie a long time ago. Well, Al Pacino, he had a portrait on the wall, and I remember seeing that movie, and it kind of spooked me. And I didn't know too much about spiritual things. And they just kind of like made a move. But I saw the picture that he had on the wall in his office. It was like a body. It was like a body. And they had all these other bodies coming up out of this one body. And then and they made it look real, real spooky. And then all of a sudden, Keanu Reeves finally, when Al Pacino finally revealed himself to Keanu Reeves that he was the Antichrist, the picture came alive on the wall, and you saw this one person doing this, and then you saw all these other bodies doing that. So if you were to look at the body of Christ, it looked real, real spooky if you saw just individually. But the Bible just says that it's Christ. God don't even see you. He sees Christ. Look what it said. He said, therefore shall a man leave his mother and father and shall cleave unto his wife, and they shall be what?
One
flesh. Shall be what? One flesh. Shall be what? One flesh. This one entity walking together. The book of Amos says, can two walk together unless they be agreed? They have to be in agreement. They have to be in agreement. Now, me and my wife, we do disagree, don't get me wrong, but we learn to disagree and leave it at that. How you say it? We've learned to agree to disagree. She'll have her opinion, I'll have my opinion, and at the end of the day, we just leave it at that. But then there are some decisions that we have to make inside of the household. And for all intents and purposes, the man is going to have the higher say-so. Why? Because the Bible says that wives submit yourselves unto your own husbands. But if you look at the scripture before that, it says submitting yourselves one unto another. It's in the book of Ephesians, submitting yourselves one unto another. So a man has to have enough wisdom to know when he should say, wife, you have the better idea. We're going to go with yours. Yeah. It balances it out. Why? Because you got to be in agreement. Because if you're not in agreement, you're not going to get things accomplished. You're not going to get things accomplished. What's going on? I had to go back and teach about manifestations now and about this walk. Because if you are not in agreement with what God's word says, you won't receive the manifestation of what you've been believing for. You won't receive it. You have to be in agreement. So now, I'm going to put this out there to you. What have you agreed with God about your situation? any situation that you're in, what have you agreed with God about your situation? Why about this? Turn your Bible to the book of John. Matthew, Mark, Luke, John. Come on, we walk in this walk. Me and Denise, we walking together. Years have gone by. I mean, days have gone by. Months have gone by. Years have gone by. Next month will be me and my wife's 19th anniversary. 19 years. Oh, Lord, I love saying it's 19 years. 19 years. We dated sometime previously before that, and we knew each other sometime previously before that, before we actually started dating. So all intents and purposes, I have known my wife for a better part of, like, 21 years now. But we've only been in holy matrimony right at 19 years now. But this coming up December, still remember, on December 29th, 20 years ago, when I actually proposed to my wife, we had to come in agreement with each other to start this walk with each other. You come into an agreement with God the day you accept Jesus Christ as your Lord. But here's the kicker. Most people don't stay in agreement. You just read that in the book of Galatians. How can you begin this walk in the spirit and now you leave what's in the spiritual realm and you start going back and trying to do things in the flesh or the natural? If you stay in the spirit, you'll receive from the spirit. What did it say? Yeah, he that soweth to the flesh shall reap of the flesh, or shall reap corruption. But he that soweth of the spirit shall reap what? Life. That's where been missing it. We have gotten born again, and then we went back and we picked up things in the natural, trying to still get the job done the natural. That's where hard work, sweat, hard work, good education. Now, I'm not downgrading education because I'm in college now and I'll be graduating soon, my man. Praise God. And you need a solid education. You really, really do. And you need to work hard. And you do need to have a good attitude. And you do need to put forth your best effort. But all those things don't always get you prosperous. See, don't connect prosperity to just money. Because I know a lot of people who got a lot of money and they broke. How they broke? They been divorced 5 times. They can't get along with people. People think that they're rude. You see that all on the news now. Between Donald Trump and Hillary Clinton, well, they've been doing it for a minute with Donald Trump. They saying, why would you want a man who want to cuss folk out in office? Well, I say it like this. Why would I want a woman or a man in office who have not accepted Jesus Christ as their Lord? I'm tired of demonic forces that ain't of God. Demonic forces in heaven. I mean, demonic forces in the earth getting up into office and they controlling our country. I want to see a man who gonna obey the Lord, that God. Have you accepted Jesus Christ as your Lord? No. Then you don't need to be in God. You don't need to be in office. Why? Because you're going to project your own ideas, your own opinions, and you're not going to come with the people. You are a public servant. I ain't scared of you. Okay, how much money you get? Okay, now I said my piece on that. Well, back, I'm still in the same line. You're not in agreement with the people of the country, of the United States. You're not in agreement with the people of the United States. You are not in agreement with the people of the United States. So why would I want you in office? Just because you got the most money. You ain't going to benefit the country as a whole. You're not. So why don't I want you up there? I need somebody who's righteous, who's born again, who speak in tongues. Man, I still, oh Lord Jesus, tell me what to do. What do I need to do by these people? You need to go back to the days of King David and King Solomon, where they said, God, show me. Nathan, the prophet, Samuel, hey, tell me what's going on. I need to know what's going on. The king and a prophet, the president and a prophet and God and the word of God, they were synonymous terms with each other. They coincide with each other. And every time that they didn't coincide with each other, you can see how kingdoms began to fall. Why did I say that? Look at John chapter 1, verse 1. In the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word what? Was God. The same was in the beginning with God. Notice, it talks about two different beginnings. The first beginning, in the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God. That first beginning is talking about beginning. Ooh, excuse me. Excuse me, sorry about that, y'all. yeah, calm down. That first beginning is talking about the beginning of creation that we know of. But the other one, the second beginning, was when God was just by himself. Flip-flop. The first one was when God was just by himself, and the second one was the beginning of creation. Thank you, Holy Spirit, for correcting me on that. The first one, here God is. In the beginning was the Word, and the Word was God, and the Word was God. Here God is all by himself. He ain't created nobody. He ain't created nothing yet. He was just there, wherever there was. God. It wasn't no angels. It wasn't no demons. It wasn't no Lucifer. It wasn't no catechism. It wasn't no hell. It wasn't no heaven. It wasn't no nothing. It wasn't no throne of God. It wasn't no river and sea of God that flowed out from the throne. It wasn't no earth. It wasn't no planet Saturn. It wasn't no Uranus. It wasn't no nothing. It was just God. Hey God. Hey Alfred. Oh, I was there. Because watch. How was up there? Look what it says. Verse 3. All things were made by him, and without him was not anything made that was made. I was there with him, and so were you. Why? Because he God. All things are made by him. All things are made by him. All things are made by him. What did it say? And without him was not anything made that was made. So now, here God is. He's the maker of all things. Notice, it didn't say he had to make it. What did it say? Without him, all things were made by him, which meant he was the creator of it. And without him was not anything made that was made. I want y'all to let that sink in. Financial prosperity was already made. Health was already made. Life was already made. It's already made. There was nothing that was made. If the cars that you see on the street today, it was already made in God. God had not released the information into the earth yet for man to go out and put the things together, but it was already made. I want y'all to get a visual image of that. Visual image of that. I told you, two got to be in agreed. You have to agree that God has already made it. I don't have to come up with it. All these ideas that's in the earth nowadays, all these new inventions, God made it. So, Pastor, I got you now. So you trying to tell me God made marijuana? Yes, he did. He created the plant. So you trying to tell me that God gave the idea for man to smoke it? No, God did not. God, Satan twisted God's idea for the plant. If you look at the plant itself, it's a nice looking plant. But Satan got a hold of somebody's mind and twisted it and said, hey, let's dry it up and smoke it. See what it do to our thinking. Let's illuminate our minds. Guess what? Now you're in trouble. But see, doctors say, doctors did see, no, you gotta stay with truth. You gotta stay with truth. You gotta stay with truth. I'm so glad more and more studies are coming out to where they actually show a person's human brain who has never did any kind of drugs or let's just stick with just marijuana. Because they say that's the gateway to all the other drugs, and that may be so and that may not be so. But if you just stay with a person's healthy brain, they never smoked any kind of marijuana, their brain looks healthy and moist, and you know, you see the blood vessels and stuff, and it's bright pink, and it's got an off-white color to it. But if you look at somebody's brain, who look it up, they're on YouTube and Google, you can Google this stuff now, look at it. Somebody's brain who's been smoking marijuana for an extensive period of time, the brain, it looks dark and gloomy and lumpy, and look like the blood vessels are not flowing well with each other, look like they're broken up. But it's not addictive. I'm so glad studies are coming out now. I want to go with the God who created my mind, not with the thing that can illuminate my thinking. Well, I'm not going to upgrade to sin. Pastor, you know, that's old stuff. What did it say? There was not anything that was made. I'm trying to get in agreement with God because I got some needs that need to be met. And I want to get in agreement with God. I'm walking with my wife. I'm this new creature. I'm a creation. I'm this new person. I got the Spirit of God on the inside of me. And guess what? And it's like, let's say like old years ago, me and my wife, we weren't getting along with each other. I'm thinking that she wasn't born again. And here I am, a hypocrite and Christian. And if things had to happen, she born again. Don't get me wrong, she born again now. Praise. She loved God. I'm glad she loved God more than she loved me. Because it's hard to put up with me. I'm not as easy as I look to be easy with. Praise God. But now my children born again is like, Lord, we got these pressing issues. I need help. God says, Ivory, get in agreement with me that I made everything. Question, are you in agreement that God made everything? Now you're on your first, you got your second step of receiving what God promised. You're on your second step of receiving the manifestation. Look what it says. Drop down. Should I go there, Lord? No, I'm gonna go hit it. And we're gonna come back. We're gonna pick up here. I got 3 minutes till that 3 o'clock. I want to hit this point right here. Look what it says in verse 13. Which were born not of blood, nor of the will of the flesh, nor of the will. Okay, then go back up. Yeah. Which was born not of blood, nor of the will of the flesh, nor of the will of man, but what? Not of God. Which is born. We're talking about these actions. The actions. We're talking about a life. It's born not of the will of man, not of the will of the flesh, but the will of who? God. A birth action. So as a man thinketh, so is he. Okay, Lord, I believe that you made all things. What does it say in verse 14? And the word was made flesh. Stop right there. Put your legs right there. We're going to come back down. The word was made what? Flesh. Manifestation. That's what I want you to see. It's time to start allowing this word to be manifested in our lives. The prosperity come forth. The healing come forth. It's already been made. It's time to see it. That very same God word flesh. He made his word so that we can see it. You have that very same word in you. His name is Jesus. It's time to see Jesus in our everyday life. So it becomes natural. See, some of y'all, you've been living life so long, and you've been living life in a sense that it's falling apart. If you didn't have depression, you wouldn't know what to feel. If you didn't have a pack of cigarettes, you wouldn't know how to calm your nerves down. And those things are killing you. If you didn't have certain things around you, you would feel bad. Some of y'all, you live off these things right here. Faith, you don't walk around Pokemon. I'm thinking about like, really? I'm gonna get eaten by an alligator. Walking around, what my nephew told me that, he said, man, I almost got eaten by an alligator. I was doing a Pokemon, he said, I'm through. He said, that messed me up. I'm walking around Pokemon, and I walked up, and all of a sudden, this 8-foot alligator. I'm like, if you walk around, I'll hold you. He said, I'm done. I said, you done, but the game is boring to you now. Ain't no wrong with the Pokemon game, but you can't get so far. Man, we try to get other things done in our lives. And the word, it has been made flesh. And what did it say? And dwelt among us. It's time for you to make this word dwell among you everywhere you go. Walk around this word, dwell in the word. Oh yeah, word, there you go. Word health, word life, word peace, word joy, word prosperity. Glory to God! Oh, man, it's time. And then, you know, hey, remember, continue to learn how to follow Jesus Christ faithfully, holy, and holy. God bless y'all. I will see you guys next time.